Imagine a world where objects float effortlessly, where sound doesn't exist, and where water boils at room temperature. Have you ever wondered how spacesuits are tested before they're sent into the cosmos? Or how the chips in your smartphone are manufactured with astonishing precision? The answer to these and many other technological wonders lies in the fascinating world of vacuum. But here's the paradox: creating a perfect vacuum is impossible on Earth. Join us on this journey as we unravel the mysteries of vacuum, explore the limits of the possible, and discover how these seemingly simple chambers facilitate experiments that seem to defy the laws of physics. Prepare for a fascinating journey through the science and engineering of vacuum, where each concept brings us a little closer to understanding the wonders around us and the technologies that shape our future. To enhance your learning experience, I've prepared a PDF summary that complements our lessons. Please download it using the link provided in the description below, and we can dive into today's lesson. Today, we will explore the fundamentals of pressure, history and classic experiments, units of measure, British measurement system, absolute pressure versus relative pressure, and practical applications. First, let's define pressure as the force applied and distributed over a surface. Normally, this force is expressed in newtons, or kilograms force, but for practical purposes, we will use kilograms, or tons, if the case requires it. Having defined the concept of pressure, it is fundamental to understand the various units used to measure it. The most common is the bar, which is equivalent to the force exerted by 1 kilogram on 1 square centimeter. To calculate the total force exerted on a surface under a pressure of 1 bar, simply multiply the area of that surface by the pressure. Remember the basic formula for area. Area, expressed in square centimeters, is equal to base times height. Now, let's apply this calculation to our largest vacuum chamber, the CDV6. The lid of this impressive equipment is a rectangle of 80 by 60 centimeters, giving us a total surface area of 4,800 square centimeters. Suppose the equipment is at sea level, where the atmospheric pressure is around 1 bar, and that we manage to create a perfect vacuum inside the chamber. In this scenario, all the external atmospheric pressure would be applied to the lid, exerting a total force of 4.8 tons. This is roughly equivalent to the weight of 2 cars. It is precisely because of these enormous pressures that the acrylic walls of our vacuum chambers are up to 50 millimeters thick. Italy, 17th century. A man is about to shake the foundations of physics without even knowing it. His name? Gasparo Berti, an intrepid adventurer in the realms of mathematics, astronomy, and physics. Driven by scientific curiosity, he took a long glass tube and completely filled it with water, sealing it at both ends. Then, in a move that must have seemed madness to onlookers, he planted this glass giant in a shallow pool. The crucial moment of the experiment came when Berti opened the lower cap of the tube, allowing the water to flow into the pool. To everyone's surprise, the water did not empty completely. Instead, it stopped at a height of approximately 10 meters inside the tube. At the top, where there had been water, a vacuum now appeared. Unbeknownst to him, Berti had created the first functional barometer in history. This ingenious experiment not only managed to measure atmospheric pressure, but also opened new avenues of research in physics. Berti had demonstrated that air has weight and exerts pressure, a concept that would revolutionize our understanding of the atmosphere and lay the groundwork for future advances in meteorology and other sciences. Let's note that 10 meters of this water column equate to 1 bar. In other words, pressure increases by 1 bar for every 10 meters of depth. As a curious fact, the pressure at the historic location of the Titanic, about 3,800 meters below sea level, is approximately 380 bars. Imagine! If our vacuum chamber, CDV6, were next to the Titanic, the weight on the lid would be 380 bars. These, multiplied by the area of the lid, would be equivalent to 1,824 tons on the chamber. Impressive, right? At this depth, any design flaw or structural problems in a submarine can be fatal. In fact, in 2023, the submarine Titan tragically imploded in just 40 milliseconds due to the intense pressures it was subjected to. Back in the 17th century and following in Berti's footsteps, the scientist Evangelista Torricelli conducted a seemingly simple experiment that would change our understanding of the world forever. Torricelli took a 1-meter-long glass tube and filled it with mercury. With surgical precision, he capped the tube and inverted it into a vessel containing more mercury. Upon uncapping the tube, something fascinating happened. The mercury descended, but not completely. It stopped at 76 centimeters in height, leaving a vacuum space at the top. Torricelli concluded that the weight of the air exerted pressure on the liquid in the vessel, countering the force of gravity and preventing the rest of the mercury from overflowing. The scientist had managed to measure the weight of the atmosphere, noting that the height of the mercury column varied slightly from day to day, revealing fluctuations in atmospheric pressure. This observation laid the groundwork for modern weather forecasting. Torricelli's experiment had several significant implications. It introduced the millimeter of mercury as a unit of pressure measurement. It led to the invention of the barometer, a crucial instrument for meteorology. And it inspired his famous phrase, "We live submerged in a sea of air." The choice of mercury was key in this experiment. Its higher density allowed for a more compact device. Compared to Berti's experiment, which required a 10-meter water column, Torricelli achieved the same effect with just 76 centimeters of mercury. This experiment not only provided a method to measure atmospheric pressure, but also broadened the understanding of everyday life within our little bubble of air. Taking advantage of this view, I would like to tell you that historically, and in the context of practical measurement units, one atmosphere is equivalent to one bar. 1.013 bars, or 1013 millibars to be exact. Today, it is common to express vacuum levels as percentages of the atmosphere. For example, a vacuum that reaches 80% of the atmosphere has an absolute pressure of approximately 80 kilopascals. This way of expressing pressure is especially useful for describing and analyzing conditions in vacuum chambers. To contextualize, the Pascal is the standard unit of pressure in the International System of Units. 1 Pascal is equal to the force of 1 newton applied over 1 square meter. 1 kilopascal equals 1,000 pascals. 1 megapascal is equal to 1,000,000 pascals. And lastly, 100 kilopascals are equivalent to 1 bar. Imagine for a moment that a customer asks us for a vacuum chamber capable of creating a vacuum of 5 pounds. Sounds strange, doesn't it? When someone mentions 5 pounds of vacuum, it is similar to if you asked, "How fast is your car going?" And they replied, "80 miles. The correct specification would be 80 miles per hour. Similarly, in the British system of units, pressure is expressed in PSI, pound per square inch. So, the correct request would be for the chamber to be able to create a vacuum of 5 PSI. It's interesting to note that while much of the world measures mercury in centimeters, in England and the United States, it is measured in inches of mercury. Additionally, there is the torr unit, equivalent to the pressure exerted by a millimeter of mercury column. A very small amount, often used to measure low pressures in vacuum experiments, or to define the range of a vacuum pump in its technical sheet. Now, if a customer asked us for a vacuum chamber capable of reaching one torr, we would understand that it involves a pressure very close to absolute vacuum. Since our vacuum chambers are used in multiple leak tests, we have established the millibar as the standard unit. However, we are aware that preferences may vary by industry and region. These differences are often influenced by factors such as culture, industrial tradition, the specific context of the measurement, or simply familiarity with certain units. To meet these diverse needs, we offer the flexibility to use other measurement units such as millimeters of mercury, inches of mercury, and pounds per square inch. This adaptability allows you, as a customer, to easily integrate our vacuum chambers into your existing processes without needing to perform unit conversions. It is essential to understand two key concepts: the distinction between absolute and relative pressure, and how altitude affects atmospheric pressure. Imagine absolute pressure as a measurement that takes the perfect vacuum, a space completely devoid of atmosphere, as a reference. It is interesting to note that on this scale, negative values do not exist, as it is impossible to achieve a pressure lower than total vacuum or absolute zero. This way of measuring pressure is essential in scientific and technical applications where precision is crucial. Barometers, which use columns of water or mercury, are practical examples of instruments that express absolute pressures. On the other hand, relative pressure offers a comparative perspective, measuring the difference between the pressure inside a system and the surrounding atmospheric pressure. In our vacuum chambers, when we talk about creating a vacuum, we refer to reducing the internal pressure below the external atmosphere, reflected in negative values on the relative pressure scale. The relationship between altitude and atmospheric pressure is inversely proportional and fascinating. As we ascend, the atmosphere becomes less dense, resulting in a decrease in pressure. Echoing Torricelli, we might say that at higher altitudes, there is less sea of air above us. For example, at sea level, the absolute pressure is approximately 1,013 millibars, whereas at the summit of Mount Everest, the pressure is only about 340 millibars. To contextualize this phenomenon, consider that for every 1,000 meters of elevation, atmospheric pressure decreases by about 100 millibars. This principle is fundamental in the ASTM D6653 standard, used in transport simulation experiments and industrial quality control processes. In the technical sheet of a vacuum pump, we find the maximum pressure it can reach, generally expressed in relative pressure. Although though this topic can become more complex, we will focus on answering a common question about the performance of our equipment at different altitudes, applying the concepts we have explored so far. Let's take, for example, our vacuum pumps, which have a maximum relative pressure of minus 900 millibars at sea level. However, this range varies with altitude due to differences in atmospheric pressure in each area. Then the question arises, would it be possible to perform a test at minus 900 millibars in a plant in Mexico City, located 2,200 meters above sea level? The answer, naturally, is no. First, we must understand that the atmospheric pressure in Mexico City is 800 millibars, compared to the typical 1,013 millibars at sea level. Attempting to generate a relative vacuum of minus 900 millibars in Mexico City with an atmospheric pressure of 800 millibars would involve trying to reach a pressure lower than absolute zero inside the chamber, which is physically impossible. We could reduce the 800 millibars of atmospheric pressure to nearly zero, but never beyond this. Now consider a more specific example, where we calculate the maximum relative pressure of our vacuum pumps located at an altitude of 2,650 meters above sea level in the city of Bogota. Here, the atmospheric pressure is approximately 750 millibars. First, we must calculate the pressure difference between this city and sea level. 1,013 millibars minus 750 millibars gives us a result of 263 millibars of difference. Let's set this number aside and remember that the vacuum chamber can generate a maximum of minus 900 millibars of relative pressure at sea level. If we subtract the 263 millibars of difference from this number, we get a result of minus 637 millibars. This is the maximum level of vacuum that our pumps can reach, being in the city of Bogota. In conclusion, understanding the relationship between atmospheric pressure and altitude is crucial to ensure the accuracy and effectiveness of processes involving vacuum technologies, from transport simulation experiments to industrial quality control. Now, let's let our imagination fly with a hypothetical scenario. What would you do if a client asked you to create a vacuum of minus 2 bar? How would you respond to their request? Considering what we've learned about absolute and relative pressure, as well as the physical limits of vacuum, this request presents an interesting challenge. We invite you to share your ideas and suggestions in the comments. Your perspective could provide valuable insights and knowledge to our community. We recognize that these calculations and concepts can be challenging. That's why at DVACI, we are committed to providing not only high-quality equipment, but also the necessary technical support for its optimal use. If you have questions about how the altitude of your location might affect the performance of our vacuum chambers, or if you need help determining the ideal configuration for your specific application, do not hesitate to contact us. We offer specialized and free advice by filling out the contact form at DVACI.com. Our team of experts will be delighted to assist you and help you find the perfect solution for your vacuum technology needs. Remember, at DVACI, your success is our priority. We are here to support you every step of the way towards excellence in your quality control processes.